This is Anarchast.
Hey, freedom fighters. Welcome to another edition of Anarchast, your home for anarchy on the internet. I'm incredibly excited to have on a person that I've been following for quite some time. He's definitely a leader in the freedom movement and definitely moving things forward on revolution, peaceful revolution. And we'll get into all of that. His name's Cody Wilson. He's one of the people who have started up 3D printing of guns. Very interesting stuff, incredibly fascinating topic, and I'm sure we'll get into all of that. He's coming in. He was nice enough to come in from London tonight. He's quite tired after a hard day of work, but he just took a siesta, as they call it here in Mexico, and he's on with us right now. So, Cody, welcome to Anarchast, and the first question I ask everyone is, how did you become an anarchist?
Hey, Jeff. Thanks, man. I'm glad that we can finally connect. I know it's been a while that we've been trying to set that up. So, I became, you know, if there's some truth to, like, well, I am, you know, am, in the large sense of the word, like, an anarchist, that happened for me when I realized that I could advance, especially in the media, a certain dialogue about the end of the state for people. And for me, it seemed that, like, there was something to be gained from persuasively redefining certain aspects of freedom that just it couldn't be done with the same power as if I just claimed libertarianism or, in the end, didn't pick a specific political description at all. So in the end, we found this to be, like, its most potent when we claimed the mantle of crypto-anarchy, with defense distributed and picked up Tim May's basically implementation of anarchism through the means of strong encryption and the internet as a technology for, you know, leveraging your own power against the state.
That's great. And because of what you've done with 3D printing of guns, and I know that it's a hot topic in the US, especially with the government, I do want to state right off the top, for anyone who doesn't know what anarchy is, all it means is that you don't want to have a ruler and you don't want to rule other people. It's a completely peaceful idea. The main tenet or the main principle of anarchy is the non-aggression principle, which means you don't ever initiate force or violence against others. And of course, that's what the government does, and that's why anarchists don't like government. So now that that's out of the way, for the newcomers to Anarchast, let's talk about how you got to where you are today. When did you first start up with Defense Distributed, and how did you get into it, and give us some background?
Okay, yeah. I think, yeah, that's a good introductory explanation of non-aggression and no political rulers, which is good. It's good. Anarchy needs to start that conversation. It's just always kind of characterized as an embrace of chaos and no rules and no legal order, and which is it's a bit of a misrepresentation. So, Defense Distributed began as an idea just to promote what we had called the Wiki Weapon Project. Honestly, the co-founder of this group and I imagined immediately how potent it could be if we could 3D print a gun and then also liberalize up that software to people. In a traditional way that softwares have been given away to people lately. So we thought if a gun could be printed, well, that's interesting, but the most interesting thing would be, like, to announce that we had printed one and then to immediately try to share it with as many people as possible in a kind of public commit. With that idea as, like, the kernel of the project, we then just made certain PR and organizational decisions to give us the biggest platform and the biggest reach possible. So one was developing different rhetoric, trying out different appeals to the Second Amendment and different appeals to America's, you know, revolutionary past. And then learning all the engineering and the ballistics and everything necessary to actually make guns on 3D printers.
Yeah, it's very exciting, as I said earlier. I don't know too much about it, though. I have to admit I'm very busy with all the things I'm doing. So where did you start with the 3D printing of guns, and has it progressed? I've heard that you've got some new models coming out or things like that. Maybe you can expand on that.
Sure. So, yeah, for maybe about 9 months, we prototyped all kinds of things with these 3D printers. We used the lower end of the technology. Even though we had semi-professional and commercial machines, we prototyped with the low end of the technology in mind. It relies on ABS plastic and PLA plastic, plastics in these thin strands that can be extruded by these machines. They're heated up and then, you know, deposited in these layers. There's lots of different ways of doing 3D printing. Most prominent, even lately, is metal 3D printing and and other ways of doing centering with lasers. We had access to some of these machines, but this is kind of beyond the access of most actual normal people. So we wanted to develop guns on 3D printers that other people might be likely to have. So we stayed within a kind of narrow band of certain plastics and polymers and epoxy materials. So we prototyped rifle receivers, common rifle receivers like you see on the American rifle, the AR-15. Magazines for those rifles, like the AR-15 standard magazines. I think I said magazines. I didn't mean to say receivers as well. And then we prototyped magazines like the AK-47 for its 7.62x39 cartridge, which was a bit tricky, but we got that to work. And then finally, after about 6 months of development, we began doing prototyping full pistol concepts. But it had taken us so long because we were actually very afraid of the United States government being capricious and enforcement of some of its more arcane firearms laws. So we thought the best way we could do it was under cover of a federal firearms license through a subsidiary, and then trying to take advantage of this old law called the Undetectable Firearms Act, which meant we'd have to take a pretty wide berth in our prototyping and constantly insert pieces of stainless steel into our prototypes. But eventually we found a family of pistol concepts that didn't require metal in order to be functional, to fire a 380 cartridge. And after about 4 weeks of testing that, we just surprised everybody by releasing it into the internet. And that was in May of this year.
That's great. And for people who don't know, and I am included in that, I don't know much about 3D printing. Has the price of 3D printers come down? Is it more accessible? Should people be looking into purchasing these things and actually using them in their life?
I have a very qualified answer to that question these days. I'm not really like a direct 3D printing hardware evangelist, but it's certainly a race to the bottom right now in terms of hardware and access. I mean, everybody and their dog are out there improving and contributing to the hardware and the software involved in especially basic 3D printing. So yeah, it's much cheaper now even than it was, you know, a year ago to get a hold of some of these things. Large firms, Stratasys and 3D Systems, have retail printers out of the market, which are reasonable in their cost. And there are other popular kits you can buy from open source projects and semi-professional that will build them for you. And a lot of these come in under $2,000. So yes, you can get your hands on the technology, but the question is it something that you might be likely to use in your life? Well, I think it's still very largely in the DIY maker as a culture space. You know, the devices aren't extremely practical, and at the end of the day you're still kind of making trinkets, but the trinkets are getting like progressively more interesting. And in the case of rifle receivers and magazines, okay, yeah, now they become functional. I mean, there are things that you can really make that really do their job, but it's still at least one remove away from, you know, actual high functional complex objects and devices that might be kind of like the prophesied future of 3D printing.
Yeah, it's very exciting to think of the possibilities, and I'm sure in many parts of the world this might become a good business to do something like that and actually produce things that you otherwise couldn't produce. So it's going to be very interesting, and I'm definitely following as it develops, and now they're starting to make all sorts of 3D printed organs and things like that. It's incredibly exciting. And but let's talk a little bit more about the gun angle. I just read recently that some state or somewhere in the U.S. banned 3D printing of guns. I thought that was pretty funny because just like Bitcoin, they can't actually stop the transfer of these files. They can make it illegal. What's your take on all of that?
Yeah, this was a municipality, I think Philadelphia. And this was the first city to actually come through with some legislation. Of course, unanimously, right? Oh, well, we've banned the 3D printing of guns. Well, good on you. You know, like, and that's as far as it will ever get, right? Because, and you can tell clearly that the people running this council, one, didn't understand the technology, they didn't understand guns, and of course they don't understand their own law. They were like, oh, we talked to the law division, wherever. The monkeys told us we could do it, so we voted on it. You know, I mean, it kind of demonstrates like the extreme, just like baroqueness at this point of how legislation even functions in this place. Like, it's just by just fiat diktat every day, and you know, we'll worry about how the rubber meets the road and how to enforce something like this later. But yeah, you can see that there at least is an approach for strict liability, just full scale prohibition of possession and transfer and making of guns now. that the technology, the means of production of these guns has at least in some sense been demonstrated to be so much more easier than it had been imagined before. So the central plan, oh my God, people will actually get access to the means of production. Well, shit, that means they can make guns now. How do we deal with this? And you're seeing some of the attempts right now to kind of get a handle on it. It's just not something that you can easily get a handle on, especially legally, right? There's no choke point, just like Bitcoin. Well, where do you go? You know, how do you make it illegal for someone to do this and play the games? It's hard to make a bail-in when no one's, like, you know, using your system. So you regulate it to the easiest choke point. We haven't seen direct hardware or software DRM and 3D printing yet. DRM, I mean digital rights management. That all, especially in the age of 3D printing, in the age of digital manufacture, where these technologies might make a number of three-letter regulatory agencies just kind of increasingly more reactionary and just kind of irrelevant, we would see more laws that basically just account or become accounted for as just kinds of DRM. This might even be the function of legislation in the future. Just ways of finding choke points in software and hardware to stop you from making more of what you can more easily make for yourself.
Yeah, it's so exciting right now to be an anarchist because the technology is making government, like you said, irrelevant. They want to stop it. Of course, that's what government does. All government is violence. And these laws are all just using guns and saying, you can't do this or you have to pay us if you use that. And more they're finding out. They're slowly waking up. They still haven't figured it out. But they will soon figure out that technology will make it so they are completely useless and irrelevant and all peacefully. This will all happen very naturally, hopefully. I hope it's all peaceful. But more and more, people start to use 3D printing, as they start to use Bitcoin as an actual currency, that will get rid of the central banks, so there'll be no need for them. There's no need for them now, but they'll definitely be very clear that there's no need for them at all. And same with 3D printing. This is incredibly exciting times. And you've just launched, you had a, actually, maybe we'll play the video here on this, not right now, but we'll play it for the audience later, on that you just released on Dark Wallet. I thought it was very well done. And maybe we'll play it right now.
Maybe you thought you'd act differently. Maybe you thought you'd see it coming. But the moment's here. And it's time to make a choice. At its end of empire. The United States imagines the power to regulate the world's first great digital currency, Bitcoin.
It's a cyber currency, so how do we get to it?
To provide a framework for its existence. A technology that questions all previous frameworks, fitted for its straitjacket. Helping the United States is a group of lobbyists and corporations calling themselves the Foundation. Their mission is a performance, to both agree with and maintain an independence from regulatory power. But you can't have it both ways. OnSystem is an international group of activist developers led by Amir Taki. Concerned by the Foundation's centralized development and advocacy, they're developing a crypto wallet that runs on a completely independent software stack. This wallet runs on the back-end Libitcoin, the command tools SX, and the Obelisk blockchain server architecture. A thin wallet, the premier version of which will include privacy and security features, trustless mixing, and the foundation of a distributed identity protocol. Help us cover the next 4 months of full-time development. Help us make this implementation a line in the sand.
In terms of the technology, now we are all being intercepted all right. Permanently. This is a state change.
My personal bank accounts were shut down. I was blacklisted from having a personal bank account. It doesn't matter, I was able to use Bitcoin. And now we're hearing stories of people's personal accounts being blocked.
Why are you so dangerous?
They were comfortable operating in that environment because they felt that they enjoyed complete anonymity.
Are you watching? Are you listening? Bitcoin is what they fear it is. A way to leave.
We don't know you.
To forbid.
We don't want you.
To make a choice. There's a system approaching perfection. Just in time for our disappearance. So, let there be dark.
And so, yeah, that's very interesting. And so tell us a little bit about Dark Wallet and how you came upon this venture.
Defense Distributed began accepting Bitcoin, you know, over a year ago. I think maybe in August of 2012, we began accepting it, mostly because we encountered our first kind of resistance from the traditional gatekeepers of finance. And I think at first it began with Indiegogo, but I saw some resistance from PayPal as well, because they're kind of, well, if you know about PayPal, they really have a distemper for firearms-related businesses and projects. And that's their right as a private company. But we were worried about something happening like with WikiLeaks, which had happened a year before, where, well, maybe we'd have a lot of support, but the traditional people would kind of keep supporters from sending us money. And the only thing that made direct sense in that situation was accepting Bitcoin, because it was peer-to-peer, and there wasn't a neat way of stopping someone from sending you money, or a neat way of reversing transactions. I had it, which had happened to me. Indiegogo had reversed a lot of our transactions, and PayPal, of course, complied. And so I was in a situation where we had lost $2,000, and it was outside of my control and my ability to appeal. So I was, in a very direct and local way, grateful for the fact that Bitcoin existed. We courted that community, and I had heard of Bitcoin maybe a year before. Named Anarchast, who's kind of known as a rebel and a bit of a loose cannon in Bitcoin. And we became friends. And over a year, while I was doing Defense Distributed and other things, I would visit with each other. I visited him in Europe, and we would plan, I think, we're loosely planning a project together. And eventually this project became what is now called Dark Wallet. We just knew that we could take advantage of a lot of the anxiety that certain organizations like the Bitcoin Foundation and other apologists for centralization were creating in the space. And then also take advantage of a lot of the anxiety that Edward Snowden had recently kind of mixed back up after his revelations. We thought we could promote a specifically pro-privacy, pro-anonymity project within Bitcoin directly to speak to some of these people's felt needs and what they, I think, specifically saw as an underservice, especially in the United States with a lot of everybody just kind of pursuing merchants and big institutional players. The overlooking of basically the basic privacy interests of your common Bitcoin user. And so we raised about $100,000 at current exchange rates in Bitcoin and PayPal. We'll have an alpha on this project.
That's great. Is that taking up a lot of your time nowadays? Are you more focused on the 3D printing side, or are you more focused on this?
Well, I should say then, of my Defense Distributed is actually still clear and open. I mean, there's nothing stopping us from prototyping, but there was a kind of like a synergy or like a feed to what we were doing as a 3D printing firm. And when we would have a design that worked and worked well, or was submitted to us from someone that worked well, we would submit that design to the public and celebrate it a little bit and kind of give it some press. And that attention from the gun community and the hobby community would drive a bit of donations and allow us to continue prototyping. Well, when Obama's State Department shut me down back in May, they shut down my publishing arm specifically. So all of the kind of pipeline of files that we had that were ready to be put into the public domain, that was all shut down. And with it, I think so was the ability to kind of be rewarded for our work. So we could have kept burning up our budget at the time, which was slight at that point, and just developing a couple more items. But we couldn't release them. And in the end, we would have, I think, very quickly burned through our entire budget. So I had to stop doing prototyping, leave that up to the world, while we basically see what the State Department thinks it's going to do about all this, you know, and also prepare, you know, kind of prepare a legal war chest for the eventuality that we might have to spend years in court protecting what we've done.
Yeah, that's the dangers of government. They're always looking to put you in a cage or steal your things or tell you can't do things that are all peaceful.
Yes, and you must know it. I mean, it's extremely, I don't think like you can own, you can. It's extremely close to my heart doing what we did there in the gun space and publishing that and to have to give that up and to know that that's, you know, burns still to this day, but it burned extremely badly back this summer. And I hate the idea that other people, it's up to other people right now, because we were doing so well and getting so much done. So it's with a bit of bitterness and you know, kind of nostalgia that I move on to a project like Duckball. I just want to do something, and the feds make it just so much more difficult to do the things you want.
Yeah, it's wild, but being in this sort of space where we're trying to do these decentralized sort of things, and I also am very involved in helping people get foreign passports, helping people leave the U.S. because it's becoming so oppressive, and internationalizing their assets, and we're definitely on their radar as well, and we're just going to keep doing what we're doing. I'm quite lucky because I'm not American. I was born in Canada. I'm just a human being, but I have a slave card from Canada, and I also have a second slave card from a foreign country that is much, much less oppressive, so I'm quite a bit, have quite a bit more options, luckily. On the lines of the 3D printing and guns, now that you've unfortunately had to withdraw a lot of what you were working on, have you seen the rest of the community or people in the world having taken up that torch?
I have, yeah. Not as, and they were smart, they haven't done it in the same way. Uh-huh. There's a guy in Japan and there was a guy in Canada that have basically been comfortable with saying who they are and kind of developing in a personal capacity like that, but I've seen a lot of pseudonymous actors and relatively anonymous, just digital characters, pick up the slack. And even like the week after we had done Liberator, there were remixes of it and different, you know, turns on the concept. And even though there's not a lot of video evidence of these different guns and concepts being tested, the chatter is sufficient. And some of the people that I know, like Michael Guslick, some of the like well-respected people in the 3D printed gun space, if you can believe it, have demonstrated that, yeah, the technology just keeps on moving, and they're carrying it that way. And in the end, a group like Defense Distributed isn't really necessary, other than, because again, we're talking about distributed manufacture. Anyone can develop these tools, right? But we were useful, I think, I guess in a popularization context, and we really mainstreamed that activity, and also the activity of 3D printing in 2013. I think maybe our legacy then, at least for the moment, is if you heard of 3D printing, you've probably heard of the 3D printed gun, and that certainly was a complication for what was otherwise meant to just be like sold to you as a totally benign, you know, set of technologies, just for like the benefit of and super status or something. We complicated the narrative of a new technology.
You know, it's an excellent thing, and you're one of the people that I've really been following and really think it's very courageous what you did, and really exciting, and I think it's opened up a whole new world for a lot of people. I also think, as a capitalist, I'm an anarcho-capitalist, which is just the same as an anarchist, really, but I believe in capitalism, and there's got to be so many potential big money made in the 3D printing space. I don't know if you've thought about being more involved or getting involved in possibly some sort of startups that fund some sort of 3D printing opportunities. Have you thought about anything like that?
We have our own startup, actually.
You're ahead of me.
Well, no, I'm not really ahead of you. It just kind of made sense in about March of this year to divide up how we were doing the publishing of our files into a different kind of model that perhaps could make money, especially for the amount of risks that it was going to be taking. Now, we haven't developed a lot of the software for a number of months, but the idea is like for search of 3D printable models, and that this would be developmental for the space in the same way that search was developmental for a number of other internet and other technologies. There's not really a sorting and indexing and delivery of 3D printed files done in an extremely efficient and intelligent way right now, because it's kind of the Wild West. There are very few standards and agreed upon formats for doing things and delivering things. Yet there's a profusion of data being generated and assembled, so it's a bit, you know, it's less sexy to a degree, and the emphasis isn't guns specifically, but we've organized a little business and website on delivering that content to you in an intelligent way, and you know we're seeking angel investment and other things. But I should say, yes, it does seem that 3D printing and a number of these like these spaces have the means and the I guess the potential for large profits, but it still seems a lot of it relies upon the old structures of intellectual property to generate a lot of this heavy profits. And something like 3D printing, to me, suggests, yeah, sure, making money, in the end, less profits and less large corporations.
Yeah, we had Stefan Kinsella on Anarchast prior, and he's an expert on intellectual property, and he's against intellectual property being something that's actually governed and taken care of by the government. And it's a time of total change right now. It's really interesting, but we definitely shouldn't have governments forcing a monopoly on information. That actually really restrains humanity. And you brought up a great point, though. During this transition period, it is quite possible that people will make a little less money because they can't use the government's force to make it so no one else can copy their ideas. But that also keeps people very ingenuitive and keeps them working. And there is going to be a lot of money made. You look even at the music industry. They were so against Napster and against all sorts of file sharing. They're making still a lot of money. They're making as much money as they ever have. They've had to redesign their business models. They make a lot more money now off of concerts and videos and putting their music into movies and as well the entire internet has adjusted, and now you can buy, if you want, music, which a lot of people find is just easier than trying to figure out how to find it in a different way. So that's perhaps a business model for 3D printing. That maybe like the site that you're planning on doing perhaps could even be selling these files, even though we don't believe in using the government to force people to not transfer them amongst themselves. But perhaps it'll just be easier, and perhaps as well there'll be some trust involved. Perhaps you'll have certain things that you do, that you look at certain designs and you make sure they actually work first, so you can become an actual steward or actually make the regulations, but not forced, all voluntary. So I can see a huge future for that. So definitely keep working on that stuff. And if there's anybody on Anarchast who's watching, definitely look into these things and perhaps even contact Cody. And we'll ask you, Cody, how they can contact you on these things and how you're looking for angel investors. We have a lot of investors and people with capital who watch this program. So maybe you can tell people how they can contact you on these things.
Sure, right? Like, never pass up an opportunity for advertising. But I feel confident that we're managing this in the way we need to. But honestly, I hadn't thought of it. So, sure, if there's anyone interested in contacting me about these things, you can hit me the way you can normally hit me, crw@defdisc.org, crw@defcad.com. My emails are public. They're on our websites. And I'm on Twitter as well. So, you touched on a number of good points, and I wish I had read him up lately so I could deliver the points a little bit more cleanly. But Kevin Carson writes different essays like Homebrew, Industrial Revolution, and a favorite essay of mine, The Thermidor of the Progressives. And he talks about how that we are passing into a kind of new industrial paradigm where, yes, there is this great loss. And it's a loss especially vocalized by liberals and progressives, which is a bit ironic. But the loss is basically one where they bemoan the loss of the large firm and the delivery of content and products by large companies that could ensure heavy profits for creative producers. But even though there's a certain dimension of loss where people can pirate music and pirate other kinds of like creative content, average user, right, in the end, your common man has a better opportunity for visibility and an escape from obscurity. Whereas, sure, if you could get into Simon & Schuster or one of these large people on the paper belt to publish your book, your ideas could spread widely and you could become rich. And these days, if you're published, it might be less financially successful for you. But there are so many more ways to be published now. Just like, and I think this is the model you kind of picked up on, there's so many more ways to deliver your content to an audience or even find an audience, like with YouTube, or, home publishing. The ways that the communication hubs have just kind of like disseminated and decreased in their... Basically, the barriers to entry for communication and propagation of ideas and content have been lowered so tremendously that to argue that there hasn't been some kind of concomitant benefit materially for more people in more ways is dishonest or even a kind of fantasy. So I think the same thing is happening in manufacturing, where there might be less billionaires, right? But there will be more people who can make a better livelihood for themselves, even if it's just supplementary. So even if you're just making a few extra $1,000 for yourself because you can do a prototype for a person every now and then, or a nice network of people that exchange physicals, and right, the cross ties that the web have allowed commercially and otherwise are a great boon to civilization, and large fences like intellectual property prevent us from reorganizing ourselves in the ways that anarchism suggests society needs
to. Yeah, and I also think that I run numerous businesses around the world, and even if things are intellectual property, like some sort of software. For example, I'm recording this right now on something called Vodburner. They have different price ranges. Of course, I could probably go on the internet and download it, but I'm running a business here. I want to just pay the money, make sure it's working, make sure there's support, and I'm very happy to do that. Actually, I'm very happy with all these things to pay money for it, but we don't need the government to force me to do it. Many people will do these things just naturally. You even look at people who release music on the internet. A lot of people are just releasing it for free now, and they just say, by the way, if you really enjoyed this music, feel free to donate some money to us. And a lot of people are getting a lot of money because people who have downloaded this music, it became something in their life that they really loved, and people are generally quite giving if they have some sort of cash. They just want to pay it back to people. And you see that all the time. So these are all different models that are all coming out. And then, like you've talked about so many times, the government is just running around trying to figure out how they can just keep this all caged in. And they can't. And it's a beautiful thing. And you've been one of the people that have really been leading this revolution.
Well, I don't know in the end if we were really leading it in some way, but like visually we were on the run harder and more vocally than anyone had been doing a tech project in a while. It was a kind of catch me if you can thing for a few months. And you know, they were really trying. So I think that's useful, right? Even though we kind of caused more of a stir and now have to deal with things like Philadelphia and even Congress itself trying to come up with ways to make this illegal, which wouldn't have done if we had not been as vocal, right, or as prominent. I still think it was worth it, and it sparked or kindled something in the revolutionary imagination, which was good, because, God, it's we're suffering through what Baudrillard calls the hell of the same right now, just the hell of the same stuff over and over again. It's like no one really believes that we can just escape this cloud of oppressiveness that is just like continually rebuilt and reinforced by all these powers. But no, in the end, these powers end up looking like comical and kind of clumsy and unable to really deal with the realities that are actually setting in. And I think there's nothing but reasons for optimism, even if there need to be projects like ours to kind of be the three stooges of technological development to show you how the buffoonery of your government. I'm with you, though. There's reasons
for optimism. Oh, definitely. Yeah, and the government more and more is looking archaic. They cannot survive the way they are today in a true digital age because they can't use their guns. They can't shoot Bitcoin. They can't find Bitcoin and shoot it. It's just math. And
aircraft carriers, right? They don't do a lot against the complete inverse of a currency, right?
Yeah. Now, that's a great message, and I'm absolutely sure this is not the last we're going to hear from you. I'm sure with this dark wallet, you're going to be out there doing some stuff. And don't be too shy to hide away from the government. I'm out there just doing my stuff. You do have some risks being an American, though, and I would advise if you are going to keep doing these sort of things that you might just want to get out of the U.S. And you're out of the U.S. right now, but you're actually in another police state in London.
Yeah, I'm in a better police state.
Yeah.
I love this one. CCTV everywhere.
Yeah, the biggest surveillance state on Earth.
The Panopticon, man.
Yeah.
It's a good advice. Lots of people, especially when I was in Canada last, were saying, wow, you're still in the United States. Wow. Like, maybe we'll look into it, man. Clearly, you need the ability to do what you want to do, free of harassment and threats of bodily harm. And the heat's been on me for a little bit, and I don't like how jealous and kind of angry I've made my home country.
Yeah, it is some sad sides to all these things, but I think it's more optimistic than negative at this point, and it's going to be exciting. This is a complete revolution in technology, and it's going to be interesting, and we'll definitely be watching you and maybe have you on again in the future. So that's Cody Wilson coming in from the police state in London, and this has been another edition of Anarchast, your home for anarchy on the internet. Peace, love, and anarchy.